Station. This is Houston. Are you ready for the event?
Houston, this is Space Station. We are absolutely ready for the event.
SpaceX, this is Mission Control Houston. Please call Station for a voice check.
Station, this is Benji Reed from SpaceX. How do you hear me?
Hello, Benji. We hear you loud and clear. Welcome to the space station, in virtually and physically.
Thank you, Chris. It's an honor to join you guys today. And it's awesome to see all of you guys up there together. First, I just want to say thank you again to Bob and Doug and your families from all of us here at SpaceX, all of our locations, all of our partners, all of our vendors, everyone, for trusting us to bring you up there. I hope your first day there has been great so far.
Hey, thanks, Benji. Same back at you. You know, congratulations to the folks out at Hawthorne, McGregor, and at Kennedy. Just an incredible journey we've had the last couple days. A great day in space today. Our first day of work and on space station, but what a great ride on Dragon and Falcon 9 to get us here. Everything worked exactly the way we planned it to work, and that's a credit to the teams there in Hawthorne and McGregor and Kennedy. Just it's a pretty awe-inspiring trip so far, and very humbling, and just we're just so proud to represent SpaceX and NASA in this new next launch capability.
Absolutely. It's excellent to hear your voice, and it's excellent to just see you guys up there floating around and spinning Earth and doing all these great things. A number of our employees have asked questions that we'd like to throw your way here. Probably the first one, and you've had this in a different version before, but what did it feel like riding on Falcon 9?
You know, we certainly have talked about it, but it's it never gets old talking about riding on Falcon 9. Just from the time the engines lit, the first 2.5 minutes to staging was about like we expected, except, you know, you can never simulate the G's. So as the G's built, you could certainly feel those. Also, what I thought was really neat was how sensitive we were to the throttling of the Merlin engines. That was really neat. You could definitely sense that as we broke Mach 1 and went transonic and broke Mach 1. We could definitely feel that. In fact, I said it to Bob, and then the next thing you know, the call was made, and we didn't even need to look at the speed. You could tell just by how the rocket felt. And so it's a very pure flying machine. And then I think the next thing that really stood out for me was first stage separation with the engine cut off, and that separation event going to zero G for a split second, and then the Merlin vacuum engine lighting. That was a pretty neat event. That was a highlight of the ascent for me. And then once the MVAC started, then it was that kind of driving fast, very fast on a gravel road is how it felt the rest of the way up. A little bit of vibrations, not anything that was really unpleasant, but you certainly knew that there was a powerful engine behind you at the time, and that obviously took us all the way to orbit about 6 minutes later. And once again, you know, the G's and how the engine throttled to control the G's, and then straight to cutoff, and then just like with shuttle, you go from in this case, we were more than 3 G's to 0 G's instantaneously, and we knew we made it to orbit.
That's awesome. Sounds like the ultimate ride in a Batmobile with a jet engine turned on. Another question that we had came about, what was going through your mind when you were on the pad? We know that you guys are steely-eyed and focused on the operation, but what was some of the last things that you were thinking about just before launch?
I think for both of us, Benji, we really almost started the ride when we got the go for tanking. And so when the tanking operation started, you know, Dragon really and the Falcon 9 really came alive underneath us. It was a little bit different than our shuttle experience where we came to the vehicle after it was tanked. And so as we marched through the loading countdown, I think when we got to 16 and a half minutes and we got started on the locks for the second stage, I think that we said, well, we haven't done this before because it was something new from what had happened just a few days earlier. And I think each one of the events, we just marked them off as, we never did that before. Oh, we never did that before. And it was pretty cool kind of marching our way all the way uphill. And so all the way to the point where we saw 189 or so on the perigee, I think, and knew that we had safely made it into the first portion of our orbit and we're headed towards space station. I think we were excited, but I've said this before, and I'll say it again about the training team, just doing an excellent job. And when we started this adventure, I described it as my goal to make it like Groundhog Day. So it was very familiar as we marched through the various events, and we knew where to look next for the thing that was going to tell us that we were proceeding normally through the count, through the launch, and on into orbit all the way to space station. And they succeeded wonderfully in producing that desired Groundhog Day familiarity as we went through the launch count. And of course, there's plenty of excitement when you ride a rocket, and we prefer the term as Demo 2, Dragon drivers versus Dragon riders. But when you go through that, there's certainly a ton of excitement to go along with all that as well.
That's fantastic. It sounds great. And we appreciate how much time you spent with us doing all of that training to make it Groundhog Day too. A question for Chris. What was it like for you knowing your buddies were going to be coming back? These Dragon drivers were going to be showing up and then opening the door for them.
You know, Benji, it was really cool. As I was sitting in the cupola looking out the window, I had the opportunity to take a few photos. Hopefully you've seen some of them. They turned out pretty nice. But I could see the docking mechanism, and with a big lens, I could really look at the intricacies of the hatch and the docking mechanism. I thought about all of you folks there who put that together, and those mechanisms that were just moments away from making the physical contact and making these two vehicles one. And it really represented, as silly as it sounds, those docking mechanisms represented to me the unity that now we have between SpaceX and NASA.
That is really cool symbolism, it's true. You got that sense as we are moving into hard capture that you're becoming one vehicle. And you know, part of that unity that we see, you guys have a picture of the Earth and you have a flag which also represents the friendly competition maybe that that brings us unity. Why don't you tell us about that there?
Yeah, so this is the flag that we left here almost 9 years ago on STS-135. It had actually flown on STS-1, and then it flew again with us on STS-135. And at some point after the end of the shuttle program, we decided we would have a little friendly competition to see who came up and got this flag. And congratulations, SpaceX, you got the flag. So Bob and I, Chris will not let us forget it. That's the biggest thing, is this will be on his to-do list when we get the nod to return Dragon back to Earth. And hopefully this will find a great place of honor somewhere in Hawthorne.
Well, it's an honor to have you guys be able to come grab that flag. One other question that we got was if anybody has seen Little Earth floating around, or maybe he's driving the space station, or...
uh,
Yeah, that's a great question, Benji. I haven't had a chance with Chris is going to go find him. We haven't been on station long enough to finish all the activities that we've had to do with outfitting Dragon for, you know, being able to be our emergency lifeboat home. So we spent the day doing that. I mean, we're really excited. This is going to be the event. No one else is getting a chance to see this, I guess. Yeah, here comes Earthy. And I think I might need to run down and get Tremor, the Apatosaurus, so that we can reunite these two together. So our intent is to bring Earthy home if we can fashion a spacesuit for him so that, you know, he needs emergency response or she needs emergency response capability as well.
That's outstanding. Very good. I want to give you guys a chance. I hear there's something else that you guys wanted to talk about or show us.
Yeah, this is that mosaic that was put on board Dragon with all the virtual graduates this year that you guys put together, and we think it's amazing. I know Chris, when he first saw it, said he couldn't believe how cool it looked, and we just wanted to make sure you guys got to see it here on board Space Station.
That is very cool. I understand that over 90,000 graduates from preschool through college and graduate school for class of 2020 are represented on that. And there's Tremor.
Now, I think that this image that you guys put together to recognize the class of 2020 with all that the entire Earth is going through, I think as astronauts, we often get asked the question about the overview effect and the perspective change that happens. And I think things like the pandemic that we're all going through together should make it clear that we're all in this together and kind of cooperation and doing your part to fight the battle that we're fighting against this pandemic. This is just a great example of the same sort of a thing that we're all going through this shared experience, and it's just wonderful you were able to recognize all the graduates in this special way.
It's wonderful, guys. I just want to tell you again how awesome and honestly gives me goosebumps just to know that I'm talking with you as you're on orbit above us right now. It's awe-inspiring for all of us. And so maybe one last question. What would you tell the future generation? We've got a lot of us have kids. A lot of us are have family and friends who are going to be the next generation of astronauts. What would you say to all of them?
For me, I would say there are dreams do come true, and you should chase them. You know, I think when we had our short meeting with Elon the other day in crew quarters, we talked about the audacity that it takes to pull off human spaceflight and how much paranoia that it also takes to pull it off. And, you know, if you work really hard, you can accomplish great things, and this is just a true example of exactly that. Folks not giving up whatever challenges are in front of them. It's been, folks talk about SpaceX as being a new company, a new kid on the block. When we talked to Hans the other day, he shared with us his 18-year story. So it's almost unfair to call yourself a new kid on the block anymore once you've made it to low Earth orbit with humans and have 18 years invested. So just hats off and congratulations to you guys for accomplishing it. And you accomplished something great because you dared to dream it.
Well, thank you guys. And on behalf of all of us here at SpaceX and all of our partners, thank you for flying SpaceX. We look forward to bringing you home soon to your families, safe on Earth, and then sending more people up to help keep Space Station running. time today.
Thank you, Benji. Thank you, Hawthorne. Thank you, McGregor. Thank you, Kennedy.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes our event as we count down to 20 continuous years of humans living and working on the International Space Station.
Thank you to all participants from SpaceX. Station, we are now resuming operational audio communications. Thank you.